что-то.
Да, добрый день, меня слышно?
Вот, видимо, вы сейчас договорите, а мы не слышим.
Добрый день,
спасибо,
да.
Спасибо большое, спасибо.
Меня слышно сейчас?
Похоже, не слышит нас.
Да, видимо.
Вот да. Сейчас все хорошо, сейчас все, обоих вас слышно, спасибо.
Отлично,
слышно,
да?
Спасибо большое, да, всех слышно, да.
Спасибо.
Коллеги, небольшой апдейт по ситуации. Сейчас профессор Блобер подключился, я ему лично позвонил, поэтому вот и как раз, да.
Вы тогда начинаете, да, Ник?
Да, конечно.
Hello.
Hello, Professor Blobier.
Oh, how are you today?
It's great, thank you. Professor Blobier, so one second for the scenario. So right now I'm presenting you and giving the floor to the moderator. The moderator once again presents you and then gives the floor to you.
Fantastic.
So great. So let us start. Good afternoon, dear ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nikolai. I am a representative of the Global Energy Association, and right now we're here to listen to the lecture called Power Electronics, the Key Technology for Grid Integration of Professor Frede Blobjerg from the wonderful country of Denmark. Professor Blobjerg is the most quoted engineer scientist in the world. He is the head of the Center of Reliable Power Electronics at Aalborg University. In 2019, Professor Blobjerg was awarded with the Global Energy Prize for his outstanding technical contributions to the design of power management systems enabling the integration of renewable power. Besides, I'm happy to be acquainted with the Professor Blobjerg personally, so I can introduce him as a true professional and a magnificent person. So right now, I'm giving the floor to the moderator of today's discussion, who will provide you with the most accurate information on Professor Blobjerg's activities. Please.
Hello, dear professor. We are very, very pleased to see you, to welcome you at the St. Petersburg Electrotechnical University. We are looking forward to your wonderful lecture. Hopefully, this, as you can see, we have a full auditorium of students and professors. So everyone is looking forward to hear something new, to learn something today. And hopefully, if after you finish, if any questions arise, we shall ask them to you. And, you know, wait for your answers. Thank you very much. We're looking forward for your lecture. If you please, if you may, if you would like to start your lecture.
Yeah, I see here. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Yes.
And
yes, we can.
And the voice is nice, right? Can you see my slides?
Yes, we can see everything. Thank you.
And so that's very, very clear now. So sorry I came a little bit late in, but I hope I can compensate that through the lectures here. So good afternoon, everybody. I'm very honored to be with you this afternoon. Unfortunately, we are not able to meet, but I hope in the future we'll be able to meet because in my opinion, what is really matters in careers to meet people also to discuss and to be better and so on. So I hope in the next years to have the possibility to visit St. Petersburg and also your institute. But what I will do this afternoon is to discuss power electronics, because this has been my research field for many years, and I will especially talk about it in related to integration of renewable energy systems. So what I will talk about is first about some overview and both in terms of technology and also in terms of renewable energy system. Then when we develop technology, we also discuss and what is dictating the technology is are the demands, and that I will try to discuss a little. When we talk about power electronics, the converters are important and the control are also important. So I will touch that also, how to deal with those issues, and then finally a summary. But before I start, let me just give you a very, very brief introduction to where I'm coming from. I'm based in Denmark, and it's not very far from St. Petersburg, and Aalborg is located here on the Danish map. We have Copenhagen over here, Aalborg up here, and there Aalborg University is also located as the primary campus. And yeah, I think when I am around and do presentations, many, many people, they know Hans Christian Andersen. This is a famous poet for 250 years ago with a lot of fairy tales. We are not so old, Aalborg University. We are inaugurated in 74, and we have today 22,000 students. I have to say, if you have a chance to come and study or work with us in Aalborg, you will find out our teaching model is different compared with many classical universities, because our students, they work all the time in teams. Every semester they work in teams, and every semester they do a project, and that is what we call problem-based learning. And then the other half time, they are spending that on courses. We are quite, we have been in the last years been very good in terms of some ranking. So in engineering, we are ranked very high. And I would say one of the reasons we are ranked very high are because our impact on the research is high. So here, if you have a chance, some photos from the Aalborg University campus. We have a campus where I'm sitting now, 6 kilometers from the city center. But in the city center, we have a lot of water. So we also have a campus in there. And I, as I told you, our engineering program, this is problem-based learning, both for bachelor and master, not for PhD. PhD is still typically one by one. But the problem-based learning has this distribution where 50% of the time is for coursework and 50% of the time is for a project. And they work in teams, so they are sitting together in 4 to 6 students in a group. And as a university, we offer them space in order to do exercises, to do the project work. We have in Aalborg University 18 departments. One of them is Department of Energy Technology. Energy technology as a name is not classical as such in many universities, especially when you look at what I'm working with. Typically, I would be located in what we call a ECE department or EE department, but I'm sitting in a department where we are covering energy technology from power production, and that can be electrical or heat. It can be power transmission, distribution, and then also efficient use of power. Now I put a lot of focus on the electrical power, but that's because I'm coming from there. But it could also be thermal energy, which we are using for heating up houses and for other means. But we are also working with renewable generation, fuel cells, hybrid cars and battery technologies and so on. So so we work with production, distribution, consumption and control of electrical and thermal power. And I think this is the second last part. And just to say, what are we working with in such kind of department specifically? We work, so we are divided into sections, and the sections, they cover the discipline. So this is electrical power system, power electronic system, electrical machines. You can see this is classical EE fields. And now the other fields are coming, which are more classical mechanical engineering. So we have fluid power and mechatronic systems, fluid mechanics and combustion. And we also have thermal energy systems. So in that way, we have really a cross-disciplinary energy department. And then the way we work is that we belong to sections, the disciplines, and then we define different research programs where we try to work across the different disciplines. And I'll not go through them all, but we have a program in wind turbine systems, photovoltaics, smart grids, green buildings, efficient and reliable power electronics, just to mention some of them. And the department has around 300 people, where 120 of them are PhD students. And all the time we have a visiting guest program where we are between 60 and 80 visitors all the time. So we are really an international environment. Here you have a photo. where this is Campus East, part of Campus East of Aalborg University, and Energy Technology, we are in those buildings here. So, and those parts here are for students and for staff, and all those facilities here are for testing facilities, where we have a lot of different setups, high voltage engineering, medium voltage engineering, a lot of reliability and power electronics. We have heavy duty mechatronic systems and so on. So, in my opinion, the test facilities are very, very important in order to do state-of-the-art research and also to be able to be attractive for collaborators, both in terms of industry and also other universities. Okay, let's go on board with the subject for this afternoon. And the first is the overview about the power electronics technology and the renewable energy system. And you have seen this photo before, or this slide before, but just to emphasize that if we look at it from transmit as a production of electrical power to consumption, you can see there are a lot of bricks in between, and those bricks are the power electronics technology, where the power electronics is converting electrical power from one stage to another stage. And seen from a history perspective, this has just become more and more. So power electronics is almost everywhere in all kinds of applications, lighting, appliances, automation, power supplies for computers and so on. But what has also come for many years now is that renewable generation has really been booming. So in between, we also have power electronics. And last but not least, the electrification of the transportation. We have a lot of power electronics, and we both have to charge the car, and we have to drive the car. We have to store the energy in the car. So all of them are really saying that the power electronics is here to be there, and we cannot live without it. So now it sounds that I have maybe been half inventing the power electronics. I have not been half inventing, because power electronics have been there for more than 100 years, and there has been a lot of famous professors before me, so and have done really pioneering work in the power electronics industry and academia. But I would say the modern power electronics started in 57. So this is older than I am. And that was when the thyristor was invented, and that was a big thing. Before that, we had the mercury arc rectifier, vacuum tube rectifier, torotrone. We still see them in some application, but that was used because this was the only way we could do switches and so on. After the thyristor came, we could turn on a component by a simple gate drive circuit, and we needed of course something to turn it off externally, but that was also possible. But there are really a lot of things were happening in the power electronics technology. So from 57 until the mid 70s, the diode and the thyristor was really used a lot, and then the first fully controlled devices came, where we could turn on and turn off power devices. And that was the power bipolar transistor, the power MOSFET, and the DTOs, which were coming there. So again, history showed that in the middle of the 80s, the IGBT came, where we combined the MOSFET with the bipolar transistor. And in that way, we had good conducting capabilities, and we also have good switching capabilities. That lasted for, let's say 2 decades. Already there, we could see that if we did the, all things are defined and done on silicon, but we knew that there are other material which could be even stronger. For example, the silicon carbide or the gallium nitride or diamond, not also to say that. So in the early 2000s, when they found out to do very good material on silicon carbide, the first diodes came, so the first Schottky diode. And now if we talk about challenges in the power electronics things, we can say that the new wide band gap devices are really defining a lot of possibilities and also challenges in terms of future equipment. seen from a circuit perspective, we can say that, in the beginning, everything was dominated, that we needed some switches, but we had some potential applications for example, the Mercury arc rectifier, vacuum tube rectifier. After 57, circuit topologies came up, control modeling methods, and of course, power laws, gate drives, digital control came into play. And this was going on for around 50 years, where patents and many things were on the agenda. And now I would dare to say that from around 2000, the things are changed a little bit, because I think it's hard to come up with a lot of new circuit topologies. Now the applications are driving it, and everything is optimized according to the application. So now, packaging, thermal management, EMC, reliability, those issues are on the agenda more than finding out a new topology, because this is very, very hard to do. So if we look at renewable generation, I would say we have not a revolution, but we have an evolution. Maybe when we go 100 years from now, people will say there was a revolution in terms of renewable generation. But what you can see here is the installed capacity in terms of renewable generation, where you have hydropower, wind energy, solar energy, bioenergy, and so on. And you can see the installed capacity has been around 800 gigawatt in 2000. And in 2018, we have around 2,500 gigawatt. So this is almost tripled within 18 years. And we can see that the hydropower is still the dominating in terms of installed capacity, but there are other sources which are taking over, and they are wind and solar. If we look in, this was the accumulated installed capacity, but if we look in the installed capacity per year, we can see that for many years, this has just been continuing to increase. And in 2018, the total new installed capacity was around 170 gigawatt, where you can see wind and solar are really dominating in terms of new installed capacity, but also bioenergy has some role to play. So then you can ask, does that really matter in terms of how much new installed capacity is done on a global scale? Is it just a little bit, or is it a lot? And I have to say that, yes, it is really a lot, because if we look at here, the blue one is the conventional, so the non-renewable installed capacity, and the red one is the renewable. So you can see the market share in 2018 was 35% for non-conventional, as a non-renewables, and 65% for renewables. So the renewable industry has really taken over the power generation market. As one of the visionary countries, and that has maybe been because we do not have so much resources on the ground, I think is Denmark. And in Denmark, we have really, we can have two sources, solar, wind, but wind is far the most important, because we have very good wind conditions. We are a flat country. And we have a lot of low pressure system coming there. So if you look here, how much wind power is installed in the Danish system from 2007 and what is expected to be installed in 2027, you can see that we are expecting to go from around 50% to maybe 75% of all our electricity. This is coming from wind. And you can also see here where do we put our wind power stations. And in the past, it was mostly onshore, but now we are putting it more and more offshore. And that means we have really changed our power system in the Danish context. This is a map of the production unit in 1985, where the red dots are big power plants based on fossil fuel. And in 85, you just see red dots, and then you see some black wires, and they are the power wires connected both to Sweden and Norway and Germany. So this was really a conventional way of doing it. So if you look in 2015 and look at all the dots we have today, you can see a lot of distributed generation coming from wind, coming from combined heat and power plants, for example, biomass, but also coming from wind farms put in the ocean. So that means it's offshore power. So we have built up a system where going from centralized power production to decentralized power production or generation. What you also should have in mind and look at here is that we have also strengthened the connections to Norway and Sweden, as well as we have laid down, you can see the red dots here, they have been less and less because the generation is coming from more and more dots. So what is really going on here is a transition of the energy system from centralized to decentralized power generation. And practically what we are doing is we are changing the system to consist of a few of those big synchronous generators to be a part of a lot of units which are totally power electronic interface by using power electronic converters, either in wind systems or in a photovoltaic system. Just one slide more about Denmark. Here you can see how much energy is coming from renewable in 2017. So the renewable share of the generation was around 70%. And out of that 70%, 50% in absolute values is coming from wind. And here you can see how this is distributed. So 70% of all electricity in 2017. And that also gives sometimes the scenarios that when we have windy days, that all the whole Denmark is powered by wind fully and even up to 130%. So we have had 2 days or something like that where we did not use anything else than wind in terms of production of electrical power. And you can see in the future, we expect renewable share of 90% of the electricity, and 2035, we expect more than 100% to be covered by renewable. The big question when we talk about the decarbonization is, of course, the transportation sector. What will that be in 10 and 30 years, and how to come with solutions for that? And that is being discussed in Denmark. Okay, so let's look at the state of the art development for example, wind power. And what you can see here is the installed capacity in wind turbines, total and also annually. And you can see in 2018, around 600 gigawatts of installed capacity was erected in Denmark. And in 2018, 54 gigawatts was specifically installed. The number is the same in 2019. And the average size of the wind turbines is 2.5 megawatt, but there are larger turbines also in the planning or also sold today. And power electronics is really used a lot for the interface to the grid system. And this is also illustrated in this one here, where you can see a timeline of the development of the wind turbine technology from 1980 up to 2020, where we are today, where in 1980, 50 kilowatts, 1990, 500 kilowatts, 2000, 2 megawatts. And today we are having a 12 megawatt wind turbine erected and operating. And I have to say, of course, we have done a very, very good progress in terms of electrical engineering, but the mechanical engineers, foundation, all kinds of different engineering disciplines have been in play in order to achieve such remarkable results. What is also shown here is that in the beginning, we did not really use power electronics only to soft start and connect the induction generator to the grid. But in order really to control the power in a proper way, from around 2000, the wind turbines were fully equipped with power electronics technology in order to be able to control the power. So if we should characterize the role, we could say that the wind turbines in the beginning was just a troublemaker. They did nothing well, the utility said. Then they become more self-organizer, keep themselves well done in the grid. And now there's no doubt that the wind turbines are active contributor to the grid operation and also stabilizer, as are able really to stabilize the power system. So here you can see, let's say, the top five manufacturers in wind turbines, and you can see the size here, the power range to the right. And what is most important here to recognize is that the concept is not the same. So there are really four different technologies which are used in order to do the wind turbine. So we are applying the double fed induction generator system, the permanent magnet synchronous generator, the squirrel cage induction generator, and even the wound rotor synchronous generator. So so this is really amazing, and we can say that there is not one system just fits all. And here's a little bit ranked the power rating, indicating that we are now passing 10 megawatts, and you will be able to purchase on the market 12 megawatts. And for 2024, I have to say Siemens Gamesa, they have even planned a 14 megawatt of wind turbine. You can ask me, why is that really feasible to go up in size? Does it matter in terms of cost of energy for 1 kilowatt hour? And I have to say, yes, it matters. This is the way we really can reduce the cost of energy. And especially when we go offshore, it's way, way convenient to make them as big as possible. Then you can ask, are there any limitations? Yes, I think there will be limitations, but studies have said that 20 megawatt is also achievable. And then we see what is possible. Okay, that was wind turbines, but another technology moving way fast, this is the photovoltaic technology. And this one here is a slide I have taken from NREL, where they every year publish world records in terms of efficiency of PV technology. And you can see, of course, the efficiency is going up. But what you can also see is there are a lot of different technologies which are possible. And there are some which have just emerged in the last 20 years. They have very low efficiency in the beginning, but later on they have much higher efficiency, and typically they are the most cost efficient. But I think it's very, very interesting to see that we can achieve efficiencies up to 40-50%. And this is also a way let's say, maximize the footprint you are applying when you are putting up PV power plants. Here you can see the installed capacity is a little bit exponential-like for many years. And in 2018, 500 gigawatt was installed, where in total, and in 2018, almost 100 gigawatt was installed. Especially because of the Chinese program, but also many other countries are applying this technology. And I have to say, when we talk about potential, which one will be the dominant in 20 years, I'm quite sure this, as a utilizing the sun in the sunny day, as a, on the daily basis, this is very attractive because you have no rotating part, but especially because everybody can invest in this. You don't need a lot of money to invest in it. So household by household can invest in it. While a wind turbine with the size I just showed before is more difficult. You need to have a lot of money. So we can say every person cannot just do it. You need investors in order to do that. And that is the reason I see very big perspectives in the PV. And there are, of course, also manufacturers for PV panels, to show them also that show that there are different technologies, both thin film, monocrystalline, and others are also used in order to do the PV panels. But all PVs, photovoltaic, they need interface. Power electronic interface, so the inverter is also important. And here you can see the global market share of the PV inverter manufacturers, the top five, in 2017. And if you look at here, we have two Chinese, Huawei, Songro are the dominant, also because of a very strong Chinese market. But then we have two European SMA, ABB, and then we have another Chinese. And this is going up and down. If you go 8 years back, Huawei and Songro was not a big player. Then it was more some other companies, including SMA and ABB. So it can go very fast, and it can depend also on where the market is in terms of being a player here. So let's go ahead and look at what are the demands for the renewable energy systems, because this is defining the technology. And if we take a wind turbine system, we have the generator, we have the grid, and in between we are coming with our power electronics, and we need of course to be able to control the generator by varying the frequency and the voltage, so we can have variable speed of the generator and maximize the energy capture. And at the other side we have the grid, where we have a constant frequency, a constant voltage, and we need to be able to stay connected to the grid all the time. But when we are doing the power electronics, we have to have in mind that this can be variable here. This typically would need to be fixed. So we have to make a energy balance storage in the system. We have to have a high power density because we are putting it in the top of the turbine. In order to have a high power density, we need strong cooling as well. As when we are putting up way high up, it need a way high reliability because we cannot deal with a lot of failures in the turbine, because then it cannot produce energy. So if we look at what such kind of equipment is being stressed by, it's of course being stressed by the wind speed. So this is what you can see here on an annual basis. It's also being stressed by the temperature. It goes up and down, both the blades, but also the electronics. So we have to be able to deal with that. But we will also have a pulsating wind speed, so this will also make pulsating power into the grid. But there we can apply the inertia of the wind turbine in order to smooth out the generation. And in terms of wind speed, we have different wind classes dependent on where we are, and offshore this is far the best in terms of energy generation. What is dictating the technology has been the connection to the grid, and connection to the grid, this is the grid codes. And what has, in the beginning, you saw, I just called it troublemaker. But now, because they become so big, so dominant in the grid structure, they are asked to operate like conventional power plants, controlling active reactive power, look at inertia response, synchronizing power, damp the oscillations, also short circuit capabilities and so on. And we see some of the same specifications to the wind turbine technology when we are connecting them to the grid system. So there are specifications for active reactive power, frequency, fault right through, and so on. Just here are some examples. One is, I'll call a static characteristic a little bit, where you have the frequency dependence, power production, meaning that if the frequency goes away from 50 hertz, then you have to reduce the power production. And we can put in different characteristics in terms to operate in a smart and good way to the grid system. So this is one thing it has to accommodate, like in a synchronous generator system. Another one is that, they have to be able to produce active power, but they should also be able to produce reactive power. So it's able to control the voltage at the point of common coupling and take active part of the whole operation of the grid system. What has challenged the technology is this characteristic here, and that is that the wind turbine has to stay connected to the grid system when the voltage drops. So for example, in some countries, the voltage could drop in 150 milliseconds to zero voltage, and then also be able to stay connected up to 1500 milliseconds to a certain level of degree. And imagine that you should stay connected to something where you cannot synchronize because the voltage is zero. So this is a challenge. And then at the same time, there is a demand that you should be able to provide reactive power into the grid system, or reactive current. So when the voltage has dropped below 50%, in many standards is said that you have to be able to deliver 100% reactive current according to the specification. So that means your power converter really has to be flexible in order to be able to do that. If you look at the requirements for the photovoltaic system, we can say it's a little bit the same. But anyway, the power level is different, it can be different. So at the PV site, we have a DC, and of course, we have to try to get as maximum power out of the PV as possible. It's a black box fundamentally, and that's the reason we do maximum power contracting. Then we have the grid side, which is AC, of course, and to the AC, we should, of course, generate voltage and frequency and ensure that the power quality is also good. So in between, we have our power electronics, and we want to have a high efficiency, so we are not losing a lot of power. We need to have a high reliability, because otherwise we do not produce power. We need to do that with the temperature management, also do communication, as well as, because photovoltaic systems are often located at the distribution level. So also some islanding detection, also if the grid falls away, the generator should not continue to operate, because then it can kill the people who are coming and do maintenance. So again, if we look at what kind of load is the inverter seeing, they are both seeing irradiation. This is what is illustrated here. And of course, day, night, we have a variation from zero to, let's say, 1.2 kilowatt per square meter, but also seasonally, and this is in the wintertime, this is from Aalborg. Beyond that, the ambient temperature also goes up and down, and many PV inverters are located outside, so the electronics we have put outside will also face very big temperature variation. This is again in Denmark, but if you go to other places like South Europe or down to Arabia, Egypt, and so on, the temperature difference can be much bigger. And that is also something which can load the converter and maybe even damage them very fast. And for the same, like the wind turbines, there are also grid codes for the photovoltaics. It's exactly some of the same things we want to do. I have specified that in also the requirements. Especially for the low power, not all of them have to be able to do frequency control and so on. This is only for the large scale PV systems where this is demand. But for sure, something like fault right through with the same voltage characteristic like you saw for the wind turbines, this is also seen now for the photovoltaic system. So if we look at it, there has really been a dramatic improvement in the photovoltaic technology in the last 10 years. If you look at the numbers, the cost of energy for photovoltaics, there has been a dramatic decrease in cost. And just to illustrate, some of the reason is that some years ago, there was something called sunshot goal, in terms of what's defining where should we be in terms of specifications of PV plants. And I would just highlight two or three of them. And one of them is that the PV panels, they were not allowed to face a degradation higher than 0.2% per year. And the degradation of the panel means that every year you have less and less power production from the panel because of wear out in the PV panel. But also the losses should go down, as well as the inverter lifetime, as the PV inverter lifetime should go from 15 to 30 years. And if that was possible, achievable, and that is what people are trying to work against now, to have a 30 years of lifetime, then there will not be an inverter replacement. And imagine electronics to be able to operate in 30 years. If you look back, what kind of electronics did I have 30 years ago? What do I have that today? No, I don't have this today, or very, very often. So here we are developing a technology which I expected really to last for a long time and still be on a very, very dramatic performance. Okay, let me go through the converters, because this is the essentials of the power conversion, and that is of course from low power to high power for the photovoltaic system. You can see here different configurations. One is where you have one PV panel, then you have a module. So this is what we call a module converter, where we go from DC to DC, and then have a DC bus, and then you go from DC to AC, what you can see here in a single phase configuration. The beautiful thing with this configuration is that you all the time can maximize the production from each PV module. And if you go into a string configuration, you cannot do that, where you have put into series PV panels, and then you have, for example, a DC-DC converter to do the maximum power point tracking, and then you have here a DC to AC conversion dependent on the power level. You have single phase or three phase connection. And then we have central inverters, where we put many PV panels in series and in parallel, and we have a certain voltage here, 750 to 1500 volt, and then we do DC to AC conversion. And this is, of course, three phase. And the PV technology, inverter technology, has been developed gradually during the last 25 years, moving from, let's say, most of them to be galvanic isolated, which is illustrated here, where you can have galvanic isolation by 50 hertz transformer or high frequency transformer, to today to avoid the transformer, because transformer costs money, transformer have losses, so it complicates more. So the trend is clearly to have transformerless systems, where you have it, for example, DC to DC conversion, DC to AC conversion. What is the challenge with doing it transformerless? The challenge is that the potential you had to have at the grid side, as the voltage you have there, will also be seen at the PV side. So that means at the panel. And because the panel is a very big area, then you typically will have it. You will have a capacitance to ground, and this capacitance can cause that, because the potential here, the voltage here goes up and down, the current will flow through this capacitance and maybe degrade the PV. So in order to have a safe system, the configuration, the topologies we are applying here should be done well, in order not to have a very, very high DVDT fluctuating here, so we have a ground current flow. And here are some examples of PV inverters applied, where we have a panel here, and then we have a DC to AC conversion. This is a single stage conversion, five transistors, a few diodes. And here we are able to convert DC to AC in a single stage. And here is another configuration too, again with one panel, and then we are able to convert into AC. That is for one module, and I think we can find 30 to 40 different topologies, more or less sophisticated. But if we go a little bit up in to string inverter, we can say that there are some topologies which are used a lot. Here we have a DC to AC conversion, and over here we have a DC. So this one here, and also this topology here, is rather interesting, because it can do good switching without having a lot of jump up and down with voltage here. So the current here is not jumping, is not flowing heavy down to ground, by separating the DC side with the AC side through a switch here. So that's the reason we call that H5. There are five switches here. Or H6, where we have two switches in order to separate the AC side with the DC side, and in that way decouple one way or the other the jump up and down with the voltage. So they are both used a lot in the PV industry. But if we look at what I'll call string inverters, but also more towards central inverters, this topology is used a lot. This is a neutral point clamp converter, where we are able, because we have a midpoint here, we are able really to lower the ground current flow, because the DC voltage is relatively fixed, despite we are switching very fast. on top of that, we have a tree-level topology here, and if we have a tree-level topology, the demands for the LCL filters is also going down in order to achieve the same total harmonic distortion. That's the point of common coupling. Then we have the central inverters, and typically this is done with a large number of PV arrays, and then we have DC-DC converter and DC-AC converter, and let's say this is maybe 500 kilowatt, this is 500, then we collect everything together through transformers, and then we go from medium voltage to high voltage into the grid system. And what is going on now is that typically the DC level we have here, the open circuit DC level, has in the past been 750 volt, and then we do DC to AC conversion. But now this has been moved up to 1.5 kilovolt. And that makes a lot of sense if that is possible technically, because if you can increase the voltage by a factor of two, typically we can increase the capacity in the wires by a factor of four. So this is coming more and more into play that we have technology where we have a medium voltage here at the DC link. So the challenge to introduce this technology is that we see a higher voltage at the PV panels, and we have to be able to deal with that, that we, for example, have 1.5 kilovolt here, and we should be sure that the isolation system and that the isolation system during time is so strong that we do not have any failures. So this is moving on, and this is one of the areas where things are very, very interesting. And there are already now a few solutions on the market where they are applying 1.5 kilovolt DC PV system, both from ABB and Sungrow. So these are the PV, but the wind turbines have also been explained before, and we have fundamentally two wind turbine technologies or topologies. One is where we have the double fed induction generator system where the we have connection to the rotor side, and then we have a AC to DC, DC to AC converter to deal with the power coming from the rotor side. And the beautiful thing here is that we rotate at synchronous speed, and then we vary the speed around synchronous speed, and then power will flow out or into the generator rotor. And we can by that control the power production from the double fed induction generator system. So that means typically the rating of this power converter here is 30% of the whole rating of the wind turbine system. And that is of course attractive because then we only have to have 30% power rating, power electronics and such. There are some limitations and some challenges with this technology, and that is that if something goes wrong at the grid side, so for example, the voltage drops down to zero or less, a little bit less, a little bit more than zero, then you immediately see this at the stator terminals. And you have to be able to cope with that. And that can give some transients in the system, and you have to do protection of this one here. But so this is a little bit, pro and cons, but despite that, the double fed induction generator system maybe cover 40% of all installed capacity on the world market. But the big one, so the most, more and more used one is a system like this, where you have a induction generator or synchronous generator, you have an AC to DC converter, then you have a DC to AC converter connected to the grid. And what you have in between here is a DC link. So the beautiful thing is that you can almost decouple the generator operation with the grid operation. And that has advantages if something happens at the grid side or if something happens at the generator side. The disadvantage is, of course, that if this is 6 megawatt, we have to convert 6 megawatt here, we have to convert 6 megawatt here, and that gives, of course, losses. So how do we do those blocks? Of course, what we call a two-level converter is applied because this is applied in all kinds of industry. So this is, of course, illustrated here to, and typically this is at 690 volt and below, because then we are at the low voltage certificate and so on. So this is one way of doing this back-to-back conversion AC to DC, DC to AC. Another one is if the generator is a synchronous generator, then you don't need to control the to have bidirectional operation here. Then you can just have a a boost converter to go into DC and then go from DC to AC to the grid side. So this is a little bit more simplified structure compared with this one here. And this one is also applied in one wind turbine in practice. But we are going up in power. I have mentioned 12 megawatt and 14 megawatt. So in order to be able to accommodate such kind of high power level, what we typically do is we are taking building blocks of 2 megawatt, for example, put or 1.5 megawatt, one here, one here, one here, one here, four of them, then we maybe have 6 megawatt, and in that way have parallel operation of the converters. And in that way, we can also say we have a higher reliability, because if one of them fails, we can still operate with three of them. In order to achieve high reliability, other manufacturers of wind turbines have used multi-winding generators, for example, 9 phases, and then connected 3 phases to one power converter, 3 other phases to another power converter, and 3 phases to a third power converter. And in that way, you both have redundancy on the generator side and the converter side. So so these are different variations in order to put them in parallel. Another way to go is naturally to go up in voltage in the DC link. That means we are also changing the nature of the converter in the top of the wind turbine. And the 3-level neutral point clamp converter is of course a natural topology to apply, and this is being applied. And if we do so, the voltage here will be high, let's say 3 kilovolt or something like that. But we also get a much better voltage quality out of the output here. So the filter here do not need to be so heavy like it would be for a 2-level converter. Such turbines, they are put together and put into power systems. And I have a photo here from a wind turbine system in Denmark raised in 2016. And this is a 400 megawatt offshore wind turbine system. And such wind turbine, wind power system, they can be done in different ways, of course. One is to apply an AC grid, and another one is to apply a DC power transmission from offshore to the ground. If it is an AC grid, then we, of course, have 2 different options. One is the full-scale power conversion, another one is a double-fed induction generator conversion. So so this is a natural one, and the photo you saw before is a system like this one here, where we have a medium voltage AC grid from offshore to shore, and the AC cable is maybe 30, 40 kilometers long. While if there are longer distance, then it is very important to go into DC, and then we can have a medium voltage AC grid from the wind turbines here go into DC, and then transmit the power by high voltage DC. And this is of course seen also. But something to be discussed is that in the future, maybe doing, instead of doing AC to DC, DC to AC, why not just go from AC to DC, keep DC. And that means we have a medium voltage grid, and then we go from DC to AC and have a high frequency transformer, and then go from AC to DC, which is more high, and in that way do the high voltage transmission. And this is fundamentally a kind of solid state DC transformer. And we have not seen any big scale implementation of that yet, but that could be something to come in the future. Okay, so what we typically, what we are looking at to add more to wind farms are 2 different things, and some of them are already done, but one thing is to add energy storage into the battery systems, into the wind turbine systems. And that can give different features. For example, if we add energy storage to the DC link of from in the AC to DC and DC to AC converters, because in that way, if the power is fluctuating, then we can store a little bit energy in the battery and then go back and forward all the time. Or we could have a centralized battery storage system connected at the medium voltage AC side, and this one could be a little bit bigger. And we can also do power smoothing. But what we can also do is that we can do, for example, black starts. So instead that the grid is starting, as a synchronous generator are starting the grid operation, the wind turbines could start the grid operation if we have a blackout or we just need to start off the grid. So this is one direction. Another direction, and this is used, especially when we have to do with cables and so on, and this is to apply power electronic converters to act as reactive compensators, either as STATCOMs or SVCs, put at, for example, high voltage or put at the medium voltage side. So these are some of the directions. Okay, time is running. So let me end my presentation to touch a little bit the control, because the control is also important. The hardware is important, but the hardware cannot operate without proper control. So if we look at the control structure for example, PV systems, we can say that we have three levels. As what you have here is panels. We have here the grid at that side. Then we have DC to DC converter, DC to AC. So typically this part is doing the maximum power point tracking, meaning that extracting the maximum power out of the panels. And then to the other side, we keep control of the current and the power production. So typically we have current and voltage control, grid synchronization at the basic control loops, where this is operating with a very, very fast operating frequency. Then we have PV system specific controls like maximum power point tracking, active power limitation, if that is a feature, as well as detection of islanding operation, because this is not something we want to be there. And then we have more advanced features which are coming into the system, like protection, weather forecasting, panel monitoring, fault right through capability, introducing energy storage into the system. Remark also here, we have put a DC chopper, and the reason for the DC chopper are the situations where, for example, the voltage here drop rapidly down to zero, and then we need to dissipate the power coming from the PV panels for a short time before we have run out of the maximum power operation to ensure that the DC voltage is not becoming too high. But the maximum power point tracking is important for the PV panels. And when you look at the panels, it's a kind of black box. And this black box depends on many things. It depends on the irradiation. Like you can see here you have voltage, current, and the radiation. So this is a characteristic of the panel. And we want all the time to maximize the power production. So this is one thing. Another thing is that it's also temperature dependent. So both irradiation dependent, temperature dependent, and we do normally not measure those values. So we have to find the optimum point. And there are different ways to get the maximum power point, which can be done by perturb or observe certain gradient method and so on. But it is really possible to have a very high tracking efficiency of such kinds of system. But the demands are strict, we can say. We can have here, this is the radiation or what is produced during a cloudy day, and this is what is available during a clear day. Yeah, so the red is the theoretical power, the black is the power which we are extracting from a system where we do measurements. So it is really possible to follow this. Maybe a little bit dark red here, which are not aligned 100%. But what is coming now is that we want to have good controlled capabilities of PV power plants. So what is illustrated here are some of the features which are being put into the control of PV systems. So the line here is what you can see is available, okay? But let me go back. And what we want the system to be able to operate is that, okay, now we follow. So this is the maximum power point tracking. And then, okay, now we don't want to follow anymore. So we want to decrease. And we want to decrease the power production by a certain gradient in order not to destabilize the system. Then for some period, we want to have the same difference between what is available and what we produce, because in that way, we are able to put more power into the grid if needed and being able to take part of the primary control of the power system. Then for some period, we could be interested to ramp up with a certain ramp rate. And also for some time, we want to be able to just have constant power production, which is of course natural, because then we are able to operate the grid in a proper way. So these are some of the features which are put more and more into the PV system. And this is shown here that this can be done. Here you can see the available PV power. And here you can see the generated PV power, where we have said that, okay, we want to be 20% below the available PV power. And this is demonstrated here to work very well. So this is what we call constant power generation. Okay, let's just touch the wind turbine system because we have shortly, because we have a little bit the same structure. You have the generator here, you have the grid. In between, we have the power electronics, AC to DC, DC to AC. And we have, again, what we call the basic control loops, like in the PV system. So we do current voltage control, grid synchronization. Then the next level, not sampled so fast, we have maximum power point tracking. We have fault right through operation and also grid support functions. And then we have a wind system specific control, I would say. And that is to, for example, deal with the storage I showed for you before, doing black start protection. And now also it has been discussed that we should emulate more and more how synchronous generators are operating. So that is what we call inertia emulation. But one of the interesting discussions for the moment is for big wind turbine systems are how they should be operating. And typically they are operated in that way that they generate a certain power into the grid, for example, 100 megawatt, and then they continue to do that. Or maybe, and then maybe also 50 megawatt bar in order to deliver a certain reactive power. And this is what we call a grid feeding system, that we are feeding power into the grid system where the reference is active power and reactive power. And in that way, we assume that the grid is there. So there are some other generators which are forming the grid. So, and that can, for example, be a synchronous generator. But if the synchronous generator here are disappearing, then somebody has to form the grid. And this is what we call a grid forming. And this, of course, we can do with power converters, power electronic converters. And this is illustrated here that this is possible, where the reference to the conversion system, the wind turbine system, is a frequency and it is the voltage. And then we are just producing, we are controlling that, setting the reference for that in order to feed power into the grid system. And this is a big discussion, how systems should be operating in the future. So it's a kind of virtual synchronous generator. It can be more complicated like this. Or should they be operating like grid feeding systems, where we are just generating power into the grid and then assume that the grid is formed by other generators? For sure, if everything becomes wind in the future, this is not possible to have those generators. So the power conversion have to make the grid structure. Okay, so this is my presentation this afternoon. And I have a summary here. In my opinion, the solar power is today fully competitive with fossil fuel, and it's just going down in price. And this is fact. And what we see in the next 10 years, it will just continue to go down in price. And because this has gone down in price in the last 10 years, the wind has also become more cheap. There has been a big pressure to lower the cost of energy. If you look at technology, I would say that as I talked to you in terms of the power electronic roadmap history, the wide band gap devices are there, and they will be introduced more and more because they can reduce size and hopefully also cost. But the size reduction itself can also pay some of the extra cost of the devices. So there are a lot of things which will go on. The PV inverters will still involve also with wide band gap devices. However, we should have in mind when we look at the cost figures of a PV system, they are not the major cost in a PV plant or something like that, but all counts, and reliability is also important. Efficiency is very important. The grid codes will constantly change to ensure a more reliable grid. We will also see more advanced control features in the control, for example, more intelligence, condition monitoring. The discussion about grid feeding, grid forming, this will be put both to the wind turbines, but also to the PV inverters. Storage is here to come. It is here and it will come more into play. However, as I see it, the technologies finally to be used need also to interplay with other energy carriers, in my opinion. So that means if we have too much electricity generation, then we have to convert the electricity not only to batteries, but it could also be that we do other kind of fuels, hydrogen, and then put it into some kind of fuel, gas, ammonia, or even e-fuel. So my final conclusion is that the renewables are already very, very competitive, and within 10 years, it will be even more competitive because there are so many plans around the world to increase the capacity, and that will further decrease the cost of this technology. So power electronics is the enabling technology for the renewable generation. So that ends my presentation. I'll acknowledge some of my professors here at the university, and I will also acknowledge that you took your time to listen to me this afternoon, and I hope you got a little inspiration from me for your future work, and I'll be happy to answer questions you might have. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor. Well, hopefully we may have some questions to the professor.
Good day, Professor. Okay. My name Oleg. I'm a head of a laboratory for microsystems and also now for assembling of power electronics modules. So, first of all, I'd like to thank you for comprehensive presentation about renewable wind energy and quite deep observation of that issues and hot topics. And my question now is about their building blocks, their elements, what is inside of that blocks. It's first of all transistors and diodes, and performance of that blocks depends on what type of transistors and diodes you have inside of that. I think you know that Electrotechnical University, one of their leader in the world about silicon carbide technology and silicon carbide electronics development. As you know, now all power modules are designed with new power modules are designed with silicon carbide. What do you think, how can it influence on the solutions in power electronics according to wind energy, electrical vehicles, trains, power energetic, and so on?
Okay.
Yes. How, it yeah. how it impact schema textings and general architecture of the yeah. that systems, and what is the benefits and what is advantages and disadvantages of using silicon carbide in power electronics? Thank you.
Thank you. This is a very good question, and this is a lot about the future. In my opinion, the silicon carbide technology, seen from a performance perspective, this is very competitive compared with silicon technology. There's no doubt about this. You can increase the efficiency, you can shrink the size, and for example, in automotive, this is way important to be able to do that. So I think we will see such components being applied more and more. the first places I think we will see the technology is where weight is important, and that is, for example, in airplanes. It is also in cars, as electrical cars. It is also to a certain degree in some kind of switch mode power supplies. While I think it takes a little bit longer before we will see it in industrial drives, as in automation and so on, I think it will take some time before we see it in the wind turbine industry because the risk is too high. I think we will soon see it explored more in PV systems because you can shrink especially the filters to the AC side. You can ask me, will new, let's say, circuit configurations come because of the silicon carbide technology? I'm not sure. I think we have almost all kinds of circuit topologies we can imagine. So I think it is more what I call optimize the application. This is what we will see in the future. And the time span we are talking about, you know, already now the silicon carbide technology is in an electrical car. The latest version of Tesla, as a Tesla 3, this is based on silicon carbide technology. So if I also listen to what's going on in Germany in terms of electrical cars, they also look a lot on silicon carbide technology. So I think that comes maybe even faster than we imagined in the future.
Thank you so much, Professor. Нажмите на кнопку.
Is it working? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi. So my name is Alec. I'm in the last year of my bachelor's degree. And I have a question for you. It's not that like scientific question. It's mostly common question. So the question is about, as you mentioned, about wind and wind speed exactly. So when the wind speed is enough to rotate all the turbines, so it can cover all the needs for the country, like in case of electricity power, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. All right. What about other electricity power sources like solar panels or like etc.? So is there any specific storage that is being used exclusively for keeping the saved energy and productive energy? Like while the speed was enough to cover all the country needs. Here is the question.
Yeah. So if I understand your question well is, can we store the energy produced by wind turbines, which we cannot use, and how to do this?
No, not really. Okay. So there is an energy that being produced by wind, right? So yeah, that can cover 100% of all the country needs. Yes. So, but what about other energy that was produced by solar panels, for example? Yeah. Is there any place that is being used exclusively for keeping it and using in the future?
So when you say keeping it, yeah. So when you say keeping it, it is also to store the energy. Isn't that right?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. If we look at the possibility to store electrical energy, they are not huge for the moment. And so if you ask
this
about
what goes away and you do not use it, right?
No, that was what my so what we use too much produced electricity for is to introduce some additional loads in the system. Because if you recall my energy system, as we both have heat and we have electricity. So in Denmark, we try to heat, as I use some of our electricity to heat up the houses.
All right, okay.
So we have done, so we can change the load in that way. But what I try to say in my conclusion was for sure in the future, in order to solve long-term storage, We cannot solve it by batteries. No, but if you take the sun, you can easily have days where the wind is not blowing. So there we have to find solutions to store energy. And in that way, I think we have to look at other ways of doing it. For example, to make natural gas, to do ammonia, or to do e-fuel, also where you do synthetic fuel based on electricity, do hydrogen, and then you capture CO2 from the air, put that together, and then you have the e-fuel. So this is what we need to look at in the future in order to go towards what I'll call 100% renewable-based society.
All right, because I was thinking that there is not a thing that already exists and you can use it for keeping the energy in the stores.
What I can see now, if we have too much wind, and if we have too much wind, the price is going down, and then some wind turbines are closed down. And then they are not operating. And if they are not operating, then you are, of course, not earning money. But on the other hand, if they're not operating, then they can also maybe last longer, right? So this is the way it works for the moment.
All right, okay. So there's not a question, like a quick question. So about the same thing, about the wind speed. So what if the speed is too high, that a rotation goes too high, that the whole wing goes apart, like breaks down and falls apart. So is there a chance of this happening or what?
It is very, very rare it happens. Also, it's very, very rare. Looking at the population of wind turbines and so on.
Yeah, because, I see it everywhere.
Because what happens is if they rotate too fast, then there is a break at the tip of the blade. So in that way, there is what we call an emergency brake, which becomes activated.
Okay.
So, yeah. And so they have put that as a safety part of the wind turbine.
All right. Okay. That was my question.
Yes.
Okay. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Okay. Goodbye.
Bye.
Thank you. This was a lovely debate. So anyone else has any questions? Please.
Okay.
So can I ask a question?
Please.
Hello.
Thank you very much for your nice presentation. I'd like to ask about the losses in the inverter system. Mm-hmm. What is the average efficiency of this system?
Oh, now I have covered, small inverters for one panel and up to megawatt converters, but I would say if we take a small converter where you have one panel, I would say the efficiency is maybe 92 to 95% or something like that. If you take the big ones, 2-3 megawatts, the efficiency at the top level is maybe 99%.
Mm. So it depends on the assets. Thank you.
Yeah, so yes.
And one particular question, you have mentioned about the distribution of the renewable energy in Denmark, and there was a significant contribution of wood energy. So it's a steam turbine, to produce electricity, yes, that's right?
Yes, so when we talk about the mapping of the electricity, yes, and where we talk about biomass, it's not only wood, it's also straw, from the fields when you have corn and so on.
Oh,
but then you move into steam and then generation. But still, it's not very big units. So some of the blue dots I showed on the slide, they are let's say synchronous generator connected to the grid, but much smaller compared with the big ones.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Are you hear me?
Hello.
Yeah. Hello.
Glad to meet you again. Maybe you remember.
Oh yes.
A month ago, we met just the same way.
Yeah.
So I'm pretending the electric drive lab, and I have a question about PV systems. So as for me, wind turbines is closed. Question for Russia, because of it's not so cheap and occupy a huge volume, not even area, but volume. Mm-hmm. But PV is not so bad for Russia, I think. And it's interesting, your slide, it seems number 34 or something like that. And you show us temperature changing per year and solar irradiance change. And if we consider the Russian Russia, so we can find that we have a snow winters, and so if we combine these two figures, we can thinking about some optimum, because with the rise of temperature, we have a drop of efficiency. Yeah. But with the rise of solar irradiance, we have a rise of efficiency. So we have two parallel processes. So when we have a lot of sun, we have a high temperature, and we can get cut off of the system. So
that's right.
So what is your opinion about where is the maximum of the output power?
What
month?
What month?
Yes, what month?
Yeah.
For example, for your country.
No doubt. No doubt this is in the summer, because the irradiation is much better. It's much better in intensity, but also length, right? Because in the summertime you have many more hours, so because of the sun, while in the wintertime the hours are much less. So there's no doubt that the main, I think in a half year, I think we have 75% of all production of PV power. So this is far the best, no doubt about this.
Without any cooling systems, yes? Or you use some cooling of PV cells?
We have a little bit same, so your location is almost the same like in Denmark, isn't it? Of course, we can have hot days, 30 degrees, but this is not a big problem. So the cooling system is too expensive compared with what you can gain from it.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Yeah, but I understand your optimization. This is completely right. Completely right.
Thanks a lot.
Hello, my name is Ahmed. I'm from Iraq. I student, PhD student. I have two questions, please. Why cannot you use vector control strategies in brushless DC generator?
As a vector control strategies is applied as a to the operation of the
generator.
Sorry. As a vector controlled is applied to the generator, no doubt. Also, they apply a vector control to control the generator. So this is done.
But brushless DC generator.
Yeah.
Brushless DC.
And and brushless DC. Have,
yes, okay. We have a permanent magnet synchronous generator.
Yeah.
But a vector control and brushless DC generator cannot use. Why?
I think if you look in a very big we talk about very big power level, and you look at the potential utilization of the converter torque ripple and so on, the permanent magnet AC generator wins slightly over the brushless DC system.
Thank you. I have second question. Mm-hmm. How can to increase efficiency in wind energy and wind the energy conversion system? We have three method to increase to control the losses and CO losses and iron losses.
Yeah, and you can try
we can use losses minimizing control and maximum torque per ampere turn. Mm-hmm. For example, I have a generator, a silent pool. Silent pool.
Yes.
In my work, I used losses minimizing control.
Okay.
But the different value between two method is very little.
Yeah, I would believe so.
How can to increase this this different? You
understand? I forget English. It's okay.
Maybe some other time, maybe, dear colleague, because we only have time for one more question. If anyone has great question.
But questioner before the student, he can send me an email and then I'll try to answer.
Hello.
It's okay. Thank you very much.
My name is Enoch from second year in mechatronics automation discipline. And my question has to do with the control of the power management system. In your presentation, you mentioned that the control is very important because after putting up the building blocks of the inverters, switching between the wind and then the grid or the PV system and then the grid, the control is very important. So what are some of the control techniques you use in the design of the electronics of the power management system? Thank you.
For the grid side, typically we use vector control, like we were just discussing for the generator side, and the same towards the generator. For some single phase systems, when we connect to the grids, we could use what we call resonant controllers, as a way we have those 50 hertz or 60 hertz AC controllers, which have a relatively strong performance to the grid. And then maybe if we are using that, applying additional controllers, which are trying to avoid the background distortions, which could be fifth harmonic, seventh harmonic, because if they are not taking out, then we will immediately see them in the quality. And for the DC link control, we could apply PI controller in order to do the control. I think in general, we can say we want often the controller structure, we prefer to make it as simple as possible because then it's more easy to do also robustness or sensitivity analysis. So if some parameters are varying during the lifetime, then we are still sure that the system is stable.
Thank you.
Well, I guess we'll thank Dr. Lobia for this wonderful session.
Thank you very much. It has been a pleasure to be with you virtually, unfortunately.
can't hear me. I'm so sorry. Okay. I've been muted. Thank you very much, Professor. I was asking whether we could ask for your email. I mean, share your email with the ones who wanted to ask you some other questions later on. Maybe send you via an email.
Could you send me an email and then I send you, if you want the slides, you can get the slides.
Download the presentation.
So I can send you, if you send me a mail, I can send you my slides and then you can distribute among the participants. But otherwise here you can see my email. You see.
Yes, okay. So we will contact you. Yeah. For this matter. And also I would like to inform you that at the moment the St. Petersburg Electrotechnical University is competing for a grant of the Russian Science Foundation.
Okay.
And we would like to send you some information. Okay. Regarding this scientific grant, so the sort of the details in which we would like you to be involved together. Okay. With us in some scientific capacity as a research assistant. Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Okay, we're going to send you the info later on.
Yeah.
Thank you so much once again.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you everyone who was attending. Thank you everyone, everybody. Thank you, goodbye, Professor. Goodbye. Thank you to the global energy people. Thank you so much, Nikolai. And all the rest who were attending in the Zoom conference. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.